The village fete, not the best of days for it, a bit on the chilly side actually. Now, it's a fete no different from thousands of others which take place each summer up and down the country. But the village is very, very different. You see, the 12 villages that we've covered thus far in this series were ancient communities, really, established over generations and over centuries. They've developed, they've grown, they've been organic, as it were. But this place, Bar Hill, near Cambridge, is different. Because Bar Hill's a bit like Crewe. Crewe, you see, didn't exist before the railway arrived in the 19th century. Well, Bar Hill, 20 years ago, didn't exist. But then came a dream and a plan. A brand new village, the first new village to be established in this country for over 100 years. Well, we're going to talk to some of the villagers, these modern villagers, and see actually if it works, if it really does conform to the dictionary definition of a conglomeration of houses in the country. This part of the A604 between Cambridge and Huntingdon had nothing on either side but farmland, good, rich stuff, fine for fruit. 4 miles out of Cambridge, on the southern edge of the road, was Bar Hill Farm, owned at one time by one of the big jam firms. But the pattern of demand changed, and so did the farming setup. Gradually, less fruit was grown. There was less employment on the land, and the old villages hereabouts began to die. So the authorities decided to build a new village from scratch. They saw it as a way to revitalize the area and to help solve the housing problem. They generated good intentions by the sackful, and at the same time they generated the enthusiasm to carry them out. This enthusiasm was colored by the idealism of the post-war years. It was an architect's dream, and a planner's, and a sociologist's. This was a chance to build a brand new machine for living in. There was no problem of having to compromise with what was there before. There was nothing there before. Social theories could be put to the test in a utopian scheme where people would predominate and pollution would be banished. No chimneys here because all the houses are centrally heated. Traffic is kept in its proper place. But to build a village, you have to establish certain pillars of village existence, sowing the seeds of a new nostalgia. Forcing, in a way, what grew naturally over generations in old villages like Stevington and Finchingfield. Church, pub, shops, and school. At Finchingfield, you may remember, they can't play cricket on the village green anymore because of the number of tourists. At Bar Hill, there's no such problem. The green is huge enough for cricket and football, and tourists as well. But it's not really a tripper's village, yet. Who knows, though, a day may come when the multi-denominational church will attract the seekers after quaintness of some future generation. The functional, spireless little building will soften up as years go by, and might become an object of charm. At the moment, it's not much different from the factories, except that the roofs of some of them are a bit nearer to heaven. Since there was no country work for the villagers to do, town work had to be imported. various carrots were held out to potential employers, a local workforce which would be unfatigued by having to travel to and from the job. Good communications. The A604 meets the M11 not far from here, and Cambridge has its own airport. And there's an executive perk in the shape of a very good 18-hole golf course attached to the hotel, where they've got a swimming pool and squash courts too. The village school uses the pool by arrangement. The golf course has seen some biggish tournaments, often played in the teeth of Fenland wind. The professional on the premises bears a name well known to the golfing world. He's Jeff Huggett. He's the one in the red.
Okay, Douglas. Yes, isn't it? Yes. Yeah, it'll do. I don't think it'll rain, though.
18 holes in a breeze like this would ventilate the work-weary mind a treat, and it's not 5 minutes from any office in the village. Tea, anyone?
It's lovely for the children.
A very happy place to live in.
It has the look of an estate, but I think the people basically are sort of village-type people, not estate-type people.
We came to live in the village, right? You didn't care if you wanted to live in a superstore, then you would have moved into the next one.
It's a bit young yet, I would say. Give it time and a bit more development and it'd probably be alright.
Some like it, some don't, but most are agreed that Bar Hill is good in principle. It's called the Radburn Principle. The village is surrounded by a road rather like the rim of a wheel, and the wheel has spokes. Some of them are short roads into mini neighbourhoods, all cul-de-sacs, so there's no through traffic. The only way to traverse the village is on foot, using the other spokes, footpaths which go right across. So there's no need for anybody to cross a road. But while it's a good idea, some have doubts about it being all that practical. It's so safe it could be dangerous, they say, lulling people, in particular the young ones, into believing the rest of the country's like it. They'll be untrained for the hazards of the world beyond that rim. Bar Hill, some say, isn't really a village, and you've only to glance at the shopping centre to see that they have a point. It's more suburban than rural. There's the paper shop and the post office, but how many villages can offer a cut-price emporium and a craft shop, a bookie and a bank, effectively under one roof? People need shops. Shops need people. The planners had to persuade both to come here at the same time. Shopkeepers were induced to take a gamble. Sad to say, some lost and have closed down, but now things seem to be stable, and owners of the smaller shops are managing to make a living. But not just from Bar Hillians. Customers come from miles around. There's a free car park for them, and there's a good bus service. The mall and the supermarket attached can seem preferable to the performance involved in city shopping, though nobody could claim that Bar Hill matches the glamour of Cambridge. They're still filling in blanks on the plan. The developers are building and selling. Bar Hill has become desirable, particularly to young people who buy the smaller houses and then graduate as families and incomes grow to the larger ones. But a lively community needs more than youth. The energy of youth is best balanced by the wisdom of age, though to be young isn't necessarily to be energetic, and to be old isn't necessarily to be wise. They designed some flats for elderly people and put them near the school. In one of them lives a retired matron, an adopted grandmother, energetic and wise, Lynn Moss.
What actually brought a nice girl like you to a place like Bar Hill to retire?
Well, although I like old villages, historical images. When I heard about Bar Hill and the possibilities, the fact that it was a new village with full of young people and it was going to increase in size and all sorts of activities, I thought it would be far more interesting to live here and far more stimulating, especially when I learnt there was an extremely good bus service to all the villages round about and Cambridge.
So you then were prepared to trade in the dream of thatch and roses round the door and so forth?
Yes, quite definitely.
To live in a stimulating place?
Yes, yes, because I felt that it's far important, far more important you grow older to stimulate your mind.
Yeah. Is it working?
Oh, it's working very well. I've been very happy here.
What sort of things do you get involved in?
Well, I'm afraid I get involved in most things. I'm very keen on gardening, always have been, in flowers. I'm responsible for keeping the church flower supply. I'm involved in Meals on Wheels at the moment, starting off a home nursing course sponsored by the Red Cross to help people nurse sick people in their home. I am a retired nurse, so I'm naturally interested in that side.
It sounds to me as if you're having a more active and energetic retirement than a professional life. Is that the case?
Well, yes, sometimes I wonder if I ever had time to work. I don't know how, because I lead a really full life, which I enjoy tremendously.
I detected in the list, the sort of inventory of things you actually do, that there is a bias towards dealing with elderly people, people perhaps not much older than yourself. What about getting on with the younger people?
Oh,
well?
I get on very well with the young people. I've been one of the families in the village that haven't got a grandmother. The mother has adopted me as a great granny for her baby. And I go to all the young people's activities. I go to their concerts. I join in. I've given lectures on flower arranging for brownies. Oh, no. I get off very well with the young people.
What about Bar Hill itself has a place not just to live in, not just as far as people are concerned, but as a place with building? Do you find it improved with age? It's mellowing with age?
Yes, quite definitely. When I first came here, I wondered how I'd cope because there weren't many trees. I'm very fond of trees and the fact they attract birds. But in the 7 years I've lived here, it's matured considerably.
Still aren't many trees about, though,
no,
are there?
No, but wind. This is typical of
Barker. All your good work undone.
Yes, yes.
Now, you see, if we'd got more trees, that probably wouldn't have happened.
Oh, no, it wouldn't make any difference. I don't think the trees have much of a windbreak here because the winds come right across the North Seas, they're right across the Fens. There's no doubt about it. It's a windy village, but I love wind. I find it as stimulating as living here almost.
Well, I must say, you certainly seem a fine advertisement for the place.
Yes, I've been very helpful.
You know, and as with other people, I suspect you should be on a sort of percentage from the development people.
Do you know, I hadn't thought of that. Would you like to suggest it to them?
You need a manager, aren't
I
you?
I do, definitely. I do.
Lively boys and girls make up the school population of Bar Hill, but most of them have got something to say about the place. They're so eager, they usually try to tell you at the same time as each other. When you can sort them out, you find that they tend to agree they like it here.
Well, I like the village because it's pleasant. You've got lots of friends, and you get village hall stuff there, where you have discos, and you get your favourite groups there, and listen to your favourite records. There's a game called Space there, and you can just... There's lots of playing areas. I'd hate to leave here, really.
A lot of people would say that by virtue of living in a perfect sort of place like Bar Hill, it's not like real life. In other words, that you, as children, are being trained in a world which is different to the world outside, and that you'd be unprepared, actually, to go into the world outside.
Yeah, that's what I mean. See what happens when you go somewhere else and there are loads of roads? It's like, say, somebody moves, some of us now, like, move straight away onto, like, a main road. What would we do? Because here, there are not a single main road.
Would anybody interested in taking part in the Civil War?
The school opened in the early days with only 29 children, which left space to spare. Since then, the number of boys and girls has increased nearly tenfold, and space is at a premium, but they use it prudently. Teachers and parents are quick to tell you that Bar Hill School is a community school. not just a collection of classrooms in use for a limited number of hours each week. It's a place for recreation and learning in the evenings too. Mums and dads, aunts and uncles and neighbours use it. And in the words of the head, Bill Norton, this can only bring good because they can't be unaware of the work we're doing during the day. So we can link the children with the community and the community with the children. A touch of the Arctic in the autumn wind which sweeps unhindered across the fens. But then this is fate number 13, the coldest that anyone can remember. There are people here who've been to every one and recall Bar Hill when there weren't enough residents to make a fate worthwhile. The pioneers.
There was one shop at a key market, and after 6 months that decided to close, so we went out vegetable meat. And everything, so we had to go in for a
free. You must have felt marooned when
we were. We were concerned of where we were landed. As a matter of fact, my father-in-law, when he used to come up, used to say we were going into the jungle.
Yeah.
You know, I said, yes, you'll have a tiger spring out on you when we go up the Perimeter Road. But and the general feeling is better now than it was for a start. I mean, when you come from an old, a real old village into something that will never really be a village as such.
You reckon it won't actually be a village as such?
I don't think it ever will be. It'll be more a small town than a village.
You don't rate the place very highly.
Well, I've lived here since I was 14, and I did leave home for a while. There's nothing to do here. Yeah. Boredom.
You left home, but you came back.
Yeah. Lots of circumstances around that. But it's sort of community. You know people. You get on well with people, and you can always sort of turn to somebody here.
Something the pioneers didn't have, the village hall with a licensed bar and people to turn to, if only to say, what's yours? There's nothing to do. It's a phrase familiar to social workers all over the country, a line in the chorus of a little number they call New Town Blues. And they've been hearing it for years, not necessarily about new towns or new villages for that matter. And not everybody sings the same song. It all depends on how inclined they are to be doing things, and on how much they want done for them. Admittedly, it isn't every night that there's a dance or a disco here, but there's not often nothing to do. The monthly magazine of the Residents' Association, the Bar Hill News, has pages about people doing things, lectures and discussions, demonstrations and courses, as well as the meetings and activities involved with the running of the community itself. And take the fate. There are stalls and stands here which represent the efforts of all kinds of people, all after each other's money for a good cause. One of the smallest groups is the over 60s, but what they lack in numbers, they make up for in enthusiasm and ruthless acumen. They'll take your money with a smile and give you a few home truths with the change.
It's too dangerous.
Now, what brought me to Bath?
Wait for it.
I'll never know.
Wait for it. I'm the one running the show.
All right, carry on.
Now then, are you ready, honey?
Yes.
What actually brought you to Bath here?
Now, this is a long story. You prepared to listen.
If you got the time, I got the time.
Oh, well, I am a Londoner. It may surprise you to hear that. And I now find myself in Bath Hill to
travelling gradually. He had relations in Cambridge, so I'm settled here, in those wonderful flats there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, I've got to assure you that as far as I'm concerned, Tesco's is something quite alien to a village. We want small village shops. That's what we'd like. We shan't get it, but that's
not
what we'd like.
Now.
And Bar Hill itself is neither a town nor a village. I don't know what you'd call it. It's more like an, what's the word? A growth. A growth. Yes, on the countryside.
You make it sound, though, as if you're not very happy here.
Oh, well, it's no good me saying I love it, because I don't. But I'm prepared to stay. Let's say that. I'm prepared to stay and hope for the best. But I don't like it growing, you know, with all these. I liked it when it was small.
But you're not just hoping for the best, are you? Because by belonging to the Good Neighbours Over 60s Club, you're actually making the place work for you.
Well, I suppose you could say that. We have to do something. There is nothing going on here. So we make our own sort of amusement.
Well, isn't that in itself satisfactory? Doesn't that make life worth
living? Oh, it gives one a glow. It gives one a glow. There's no two ways about it.
I never expected to find poetry in Bar Hill.
Oh, you don't know what's hidden here.
Bar Hill does conform to the dictionary definition of a village, a conglomeration of houses in the countryside. But it is questionable whether or not it conforms to the folk definition. It's not so much a growth as an implant, technically sound, mechanically efficient. No problems here with roads built for horses straining to accommodate the lorry and the car. No stables or mills to convert. No church towers or steeples to maintain by charities. No tombstones, no tradition. Bar Hill's past began only yesterday. The signs say it's a village. Only the people can make it one.
Well, that's it. 13 villages. I hope you enjoy the trip. Now, that may be the end of that particular tour, but we're already on the road looking for new places to visit, new people to meet. We've had a lot of invitations. In fact, some of the people you've already met have invited us back, believe it or not. Maybe they want us to apologise. Who knows? Anyway, if you have any village ideas, do drop me a line. Meanwhile, next Sunday at 5 o'clock, John Bly is going to be here to present a new series of Heirloom. Portrait comes back in the autumn. Join me if you can. I'll put you in the picture.